Good evening. Welcome to the All Ears Boffomundo Show. My name is Ron Curtis. My partner over here, his name is Aaron Weiner.
Yes, our guest this evening is John Wetton of the British band UK. Band's been touring around the United States, is on the West Coast now, and as a matter of fact, as we speak this evening, their run will have just ended at the Long Beach Arena with Jethro Tull. They were in town not too long ago, and we're very excited to have you here with your recent release, Night After Night, the live album.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah.
To begin with, I'd like to ask you a question, that being, your music has been classified by your fans and by the press and so on as being, you know, through the years with your experiences with King Crimson and with UK, as being, mm-hmm. quote, progressive. It's labeled progressive.
Yeah.
What we'd really like to know to start off the conversation is, how do you feel about that term and how do you view your music? What style or whatever?
Yeah, well, I've always thought of the word progressive as being a very much maligned word, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's bandied about as a sort of art form, progressive music. When it's not necessarily progressive, that is, it's not necessarily moving forward. I feel that our music is kind of progressive. I like the fact that it is a little bit exploratory sometimes. I refer to Crimson as a progressive band, definitely, because that we never knew what we were going to do half the time. You know, we'd say just improvise, and that I think is fairly progressive. But UK doesn't improvise at all, really, only in individual solos and things. So we're a little bit more stylized than King Crimson was. Crimson had that sort of anarchy on stage, if you like, which we don't have.
There was lots of improvisation.
Right, we're much more sort of streamlined and down-to-earth unit now. That was kind of the differences between myself and Robert when we had the band together, King Crimson. He liked the sort of less organized, structured side of things.
More random.
Yeah, I preferred the more kind of structured, disciplined stuff. We kind of compromised on that during King Crimson's reign. Right? Mm-hmm. Now I've got my way, and Robert's got his way. We're both doing exactly what we wanted to do, really.
Well, by the nature of your music in UK, for example, that being, it's very intricate and it's a great challenge to the instrumentalist to play it correctly. It takes a serious effort, in a sense, to play the music. How seriously do you take the music, though? I mean, you know, the lyrics and the
most of the lyrics are personal. They're through past experiences. I'm not very much in favor of the kind of 1969 hippie era, if you like. Most of my lyrics are very realistic. They're about experiences, not this kind of whole fantasy thing that evolved in the late 60s and early 70s. I think there's very much a trend going away from that now, back to reality. I mean, you can see that by all these kind of power pop bands that are becoming popular at the moment. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's all absolutely realistic, down to earth. I like the fact that we're in the same kind of mold that we write realistic music. Not stuff that takes you out into the cosmos, because not so many people smoke pot anymore and take acid. People who go to concerts nowadays just want to sit there and listen to the music.
See, I told you.
where have I been for so long?
Yeah.
I'm very confused.
San Francisco.
When you were writing with King Crimson, what part did you play in the actual compositions? You mentioned that King Crimson's music was more improvisation, it was looser, you really didn't have much of an idea as to what you were going to be doing, it just kind of happened. And yet many of the songs during the time you were with King Crimson are credited to both you and Robert Fripp. How did get along writing with him as opposed to writing with Eddie Jobson now?
It was literally, we'd pull our ideas. If we had two ideas that were compatible, we'd put them together. And usually one was my idea and one was Robert's idea. It varied as to who came up with the original one. There's one particular thorn in my side, which is Starless, the track Starless. I wrote that with the express purpose of having it as the title track of Starless and Bible Black, which was the album previous to one that it was on. And when I presented the idea, that was the melody, chords, everything, I got a totally cold reaction. Nobody liked it. hated it. You know, both Robert and Bill said, "No, I'm not quite sure about that. Don't like it." So I thought, "Oh well, I only think it's one of the best things I've written, so I'll keep that." You know, so I pouted and stumped out of the rehearsal. Then lo and behold, about 8 months later, when we were recording Red, both Robert and Bill said, "Hey, what about that song that you came up with last time?" And I said, "Oh, you mean this one, Stars and Bible Black? Yeah, it's a great tune, that, you know." And I was open mouth at the time. So that was then reinstated into the upper echelons of the Crimson stage act. But unfortunately, we couldn't call it Silas and Bible Black because we already called an improvisational track Silas and Bible Black. Right. So it appeared on the later album as Starless. But that was an incident of me coming along with an idea, almost finished. Then Robert added an intro, and Bill added that whole second section to the tune. So that was very much a sort of corporate group piece of music, if you like. Easy Money came about, I think, the same way. Robert had the idea for the verse. I came along with the chorus. And that's about it. I mean, we used to just write literally in the rehearsal hall.
Well, in terms of the music now you're composing with Eddie Jobson in UK, in contrast or in comparison to a pop song, how do you compose your very intricate and somewhat extended tunes?
We do that as a collaboration. Sometimes the original idea will come from a keyboard mood. Say Alaska, for instance. I mean, that is totally Eddie's thing. I mean, he wrote that specifically for the CS80, the Yamaha synthesizer that he uses.
Nice toy.
Yes, very nice. He came along with that and as almost a completed piece of music, and we just played it per se. Other times, as with Nothing to Lose, I come in with the bulk of it. He rearranged two verses, and then I wrote the lyrics, and that then becomes a Jobson-Wetton collaboration. In the Dead of Night, Eddie came along with most of the ideas in chord forms, that is, without melody, just with the chords. I put the melody on, then I go away and write the lyrics to it. Other times, I get a lyrical idea, and we'll put music to it. So there's so many different ways you can write. It's best not to stick to a strict format, really. Mm-hmm. Just do it as it comes out, you know.
Going back to you mentioned about the Red album. Now, that was the last studio album that King Crimson did. When
That's right,
you went in
yeah.
the studio, or during the time you spent there, did you have any idea that that would be the last album?
No.
Did Rob? Because we talked to Robert, and he just said he just suddenly.
It was totally out of the blue. Out of the blue. I mean, we finished the album. We're very pleased with it, or I was anyway. I don't know about anybody else. And we'd invited Ian McDonald to rejoin the band.
Right. Yeah.
Now this was somewhat of a revolution with Robert because they'd been sort of arch enemies. McDonald always writing the sort of commercial melody lines. Like, I mean, he wrote In the Call of the Crimson King. You've got to give the guy his due. He, having written that, I mean, that's a monster tune. He is capable of writing incredible melodies. I mean, I don't really see why Foreigner haven't got all these amazing tunes on their album.
I do agree with
because
you.
Because Ian is capable of writing incredible stuff. Now, as their arch enemy ship had been, the sort of flame between them had been temporarily put out. And they both buried the hatchets. We thought this is great, you know, because it not only is it a really good guy joining the band again, but he is one of the original members,
That's
and he
right.
can contribute an awful
full
lot.
Circle.
Absolutely, yeah. And it would have given the group much more credibility anyway. Mm-hmm. Not that it needed much more, but it was just seemed so right for that to happen. And at the time, Crimson were kind of poised at the mass popularity level, just about to become popular. We had a very staunch following of about 4,000 people in each town. And we just felt that we were about to get over that hump, and then we could take off. And that would have been what would have crunched it for me, would have been Ian rejoining the band. We had a tour set for North America, Europe, Japan, South America, Australia. And Robert just phoned up out of the blue and said, in his own inimitable Dorset accent, that he felt he couldn't go through with it, and he wanted to take at least a year off. Hmm. And I just sort of went, you know, what do you say when somebody's just sort of taking away your best toy, you know?
Yeah.
At that time, though, I had already agreed to join Roxy Music for one tour, just as a joke, really. Not a joke, a laugh. Because they have always had trouble finding bass players.
Yeah, they always had a and different one them. In each album.
Always had trouble keeping them as well. So they asked me to come along to their audition to sort through which bass players were good and which ones weren't. And at the end of a couple of days, I'd just seen 30 bass players, all of whom were terrible. And I said, look, I can't really say that I like any of them. So they said, well, we're going to go on the road in a week, you know. We'll be in Newcastle City Hall this time next week. And I said, well, I'll do it then. I'll do the first part of the tour until you get someone else. And it was halfway through the tour that the phone call from Fripp came. And he said, well, why don't you carry on without me? And I said, well, I don't think we could actually do that. And our management company weren't very keen on that. I mean, to go on without Robert was a little bit dangerous, you know. And so we had to sort of drop the idea. I had already joined Roxy by then, because Robert had told me that he couldn't do it anymore. So I just said to Roxy, right, I'll just carry on with you then. I did the North American and the European tour with Roxy Music.
Did Fripp give any specific reasons as to why he couldn't go on
anymore? Yeah, that he didn't want the group to become a sort of dinosaur. But I think the main reason that he didn't want to do it, now, you've probably had this from the horse's mouth.
Yeah.
But he just is frightened that the world's going to end in 1981 or something. And so
it's already 10 after 3.
Yeah.
Boy, better hurry up.
And so anyway, he wanted to prepare himself for it. Now, my attitude is, the world may end in 1981. I could get run over this time next year, but let's get a good tour in first.
Yeah. Just in case.
Yeah.
Right. I understand.
So that was a little bit peeving to me to have the group that you just put 3 years of your life into and that you're quite happy with just thrown out of the window. Mm-hmm. However, I'd always wanted to get back to doing something like that. Maybe where I had 25% of the interest in the group, mm-hmm. you know, which is why we formed the first band UK like that. We didn't have to really give Alan a quarter membership of the group. After all, he'd been used to doing gigs on wages. Everybody he'd played with before us, he'd been a paid member of the band, you know, like on a stipend. We welcomed him with open arms and said, okay, Alan, here's 25% of the group. And so we suddenly started thinking halfway through the first tour, Eddie and myself, because we formed the band really. We formed it as a trio, but Bill didn't agree to join the band until after we'd actually written most of the material. Hmm. So we had to wait for Bill for about a month while he was doing a solo album. And he still said that at the end of his solo album, he wasn't sure whether he wanted to join the band. But I think he had a meeting with his managers and they said, listen, there's no better way to promote your solo album than by going on the road with a new group, you know, UK. So Bill, commercial mind, thinks, okay, yeah, that's a good idea. So he said, yes, lads, all right, I'll join.
Poor commercial mind, frustrated.
I'll join the band. Eddie and I were halfway through the album's material by then. We'd already written The Dead of Night and 30 Years, something like that.
That's my personal favorite on that album.
Is it? Oh, good. Good, yes.
I get chills up and down my spine when I hear that.
Oh, that's pleasing to hear.
Oh, it's beautiful. That's absolutely beautiful.
One of my melodies that I put in the same sort of bracket as Starless, you know. It's
one
of those
beautiful
good
melody.
English melodies.
I'm surprised you didn't put it on the live album. I was hoping that you... Ah,
there. Yes.
Well, but maybe then again, you could have done...
Maybe it'll be on volume two.
Aha. Uh-huh. Great.
There you go.
I don't actually think we play 30 Years that well on stage. We do the opening section okay, but the main sort of heavy section, I don't think we play that very well yet. Mm-hmm. I think we could play it a lot better. So possibly there'll be another live album, and 30 Years would definitely be on that. Where was I in the story? Oh, yes, Bill.
Right.
So we'd written half the material for the album. Bill then suddenly decides he does want to join the band. So we rehearse as a three-piece. Bill says, I've got this great guitar player that I've been working with. Alan comes in, floors everybody, because I mean, he is a sensational guitar player,
yes.
No doubt about that. And so I thought, this guy's going to kill him in America when he gets there. He's really good, you know. And he didn't. A lot of people liked it, but not everybody.
Well, he didn't have a charismatic stance on stage.
Exactly.
No, but his playing makes up for it.
I mean, exactly. His playing is incredible.
For some people, not. But they like.
He isn't very animated. He just kind of stands there. He's more like a traditional jazz
player. Like having a great book inside a case that's locked. Now, the book can be absolutely fantastic, but unless you can open the box to see the book, you'll never realize its true potential.
Right.
You're working in the dark. And I think that's what most people's attitude to Alan was. They think, oh, this guy's good, but he's not really telling me that he's any good. I mean, he used to take two steps backwards as soon as the spotlight hit him.
Right.
And
yeah,
I noticed that.
Yeah.
He was always fiddling about with stupid boxes at the side of the stage that were crackling and grunting. But I think it's enormously wasted talent, really, Alan. He won't stay in a band long enough for anybody to recognize him, you know. It takes a lot of hard work to actually get most people to know who you are. I mean, okay, a lot of the people tonight at Long Beach will know that the opening band is called UK, but only a small percentage of them will know who I am and who Eddie is and who Terry is. Probably less people will know who Terry is than will know who I am or Eddie is.
Mm-hmm.
But then, I mean, you've got to come back again a time after time after time to impress them, you know, that, yes, I'm the bass player and the singer and my name is John Wetton and therefore they can associate mm-hmm. with me. Just seeing somebody once on the stage is not a very long relationship with
people
them.
Tend to forget quickly.
Very much so, yeah. Very much so. Unless you come back again and say, yes, here I am,
mm-hmm.
yeah, we really are a band and we're going to stay
right.
together.
Yeah.
So now you can come and see us if you like.
Yeah.
Now Alan's not prepared to do that. He'll flip from one band to another. And he'll have his sort of clique, bunch of fans that'll follow him around. But for me, that's not enough. I want more than that, you know. I want a sort of solid following, you know,
mm-hmm.
to do something fully, rather than just keep skipping about. Also, to be in control of my own destiny, which is what I felt I wasn't with the bands between Crimson and UK.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask, the groups, especially UK and Crimson, started off with a core of five, and it was narrowed down to three.
To three, yeah.
Is it anything to do with the nature of the music that you always lose some members, that the personal changing crises always happen?
It's funny, because Crimson started at five and went to three, and UK started at five and went to three.
Well, actually, UK started as three.
It went to four.
Then went back to three again.
Yeah.
Because, as I say, Alan, it was like a mistake to invite Alan in as a 25% shareholder, because he wasn't going to stay that long anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And so the band really was a three-piece plus one.
Mm-hmm. Well, is it anything to do with the style of music that you lose the players that they don't stick, or is it just a matter of circumstance, a coincidence?
No, it is something to do with the kind of players we are.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're always looking for quite high standard of... I mean, there's so many qualifications for being in a band. When we were looking for a guitar player to replace Alan, which we thought of at first, the guy's got to be compatible on a sort of fairly sociable level. He's got to be able to play very well. He's got to be able to play music that we like and that he likes. And there's all these variables. It's ridiculous when you're looking for someone to play with. It's not just the first guy that plays okay comes and joins the band. You know, you might find that he's never been on a stage of more than 400 people before, but go out in front of 20,000 people who's going to freak the guy out. Or any number of things. He might be very temperamental in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
You just don't know. And you're very lucky to find three people that can play together.
It's almost like being married. You really have to find people that you're really compatible with.
Yeah. And Alan wasn't in many of those respects. So I actually wanted to replace Alan quite early on in the tour because he refused to play anything that was vaguely kind of rock orientated. He only wanted to play stuff that was more jazz orientated. And I said to Bill at the end of the first American tour, we were going back to New York together, and I said, listen, if there was a split in the group, who would you go with? Would it be Alan or would it be me? And Bill said, oh, I'd go with Alan, definitely. And so I stored this piece of information. When I brought it out again, 6 months later, when I said to Bill, we've decided that you're going to be replaced. During that tour, we'd mentioned to our managers that we weren't happy. Alan was definitely going in a different direction, and we couldn't see working with him much longer. And after this discussion with Bill, I kind of mentally thought, well, if we're going to get rid of Alan, then we'll have to get rid of Bill, because Bill is going to go with Alan. So we contacted Terry, because he seemed like a very good candidate for replacing Bill.
And who was he playing with at that time?
He was playing with the Brecker Brothers at that time. And we had meetings with our managers, and we said, if Alan's going to go, then Bill's going to have to go, and we've got Terry lined up to replace them. And so we worked on that assumption. And when we got back to London after the second tour, I said to Bill, well, that's it, buddy. Let's go our separate ways. And he said, well, why is that? You know, why are you getting rid of me? And I said, well, don't you remember that conversation? Mm-hmm. And I said, if there was a split in the band, you would go with Alan. And he said, oh, it's totally unfair to bring up a conversation like that in the back of a car going back to New York at 3 o'clock in the morning. I said, well, what other times do I ask? You know, that seemed like a fairly reasonable time to discuss that. And he did a bit of backpedaling at that stage, but our minds were already made up. Mm. We wanted to continue in our sort of British way of making music, European type progressive music, if you like. Bill was more interested in playing the sort of West Coast jazz music. Now, that's not our forte, as far as I see it. Bill's not a great jazz drummer either. He's a great rock drummer. And a great rock drummer doesn't necessarily play good jazz, you know.
Heard his albums? Do you enjoy his albums?
No, not really. I must say, it's a little bit too, I think the word fussy. It's, you never get a melody in a sort of dramatic form. It's usually two bars of this, then two bars of something else, you know. Mm-hmm. I never find it totally satisfying. The idea is never taken to its logical conclusion. It's always changed too much by the time it's got there. And so you see the different, I mean, it's pretty obvious now why the split happened when you listen to the results, that is Bill's solo album and the new UK albums. Mm-hmm. We want to play rock. We don't want to play Black Sabbath type rock, but we want to play interesting, intelligent rock, progressive rock, if you like, mm-hmm. but not jazz and not jazz rock fusion, mm-hmm. which is a word I didn't want to be associated with the band. I think we've just about wiped the last speck of fusion dandruff off our shoulders. Most people now accept UK as a rock band.
I'd like to ask you, I'd like to go back to your beginnings and ask you how you were inspired to play music to begin with as a youngster, and what did you start doing when you get your beginnings?
This is quite interesting. As fate would have it, my brother plays classical organ in a church. He's a choir master. And from that high, I had Bach, Beethoven, Chopin ringing in my ears all the time. I didn't realize that I liked it until I was about 6 or 7. And then it started to dawn on me that classical music was quite a good thing, you know, it wasn't bad at all. And by then I could already sort of hum most popular classics. At the age of 7, I could walk around whistling Toccata and Fugue in D minor, you know. And my brother, when he practiced, obviously he didn't have the pedals that you have on a church organ, so he used to ask me to play some of the bass lines on the piano while he concentrated on his hand parts. And I got to like bass lines, because Bach bass lines are incredibly interesting.
Yeah.
So I thought, this is good. I like bass lines. That's me. You know, like it. Counter melodies, harmonies, bass lines, lovely. So, the last thing you want to be doing really is being compared to your brother, who's already 6 years older and very good at what he's doing. I mean, it's be one of those things where I'd never quite be as good as my brother. Now, I can't really take that. So I chose to go into sort of rock and roll when R&B hit Britain.
Can you pinpoint a year or maybe just an...
I can only think it must have been around about 1963, something around 62, 63. Mm-hmm. I started playing R&B music and that all that sort of instrumental stuff that used to happen, you know, guitar instrumentals. I started playing those and singing in an R&B band. And then around about the end of the 60s, things started to get interesting because rock music, simple rock music, was given harmony and melody and counterpoint, and things started to get off the ground, which is where that whole bunch of bands came from, you know, the Yes, ELP and King Crimson and Jethro Tull.
And Genesis.
Genesis. I mean, at one time in 1969-70, you could go to the Marquee and see three bands for about $1 that would now cost you $75.
Three bands for $1?
Yeah. You'd get to the...
Sounds like Thrifty Mart Special.
You can't even go to a club here and see a band at all for $1. Well, I guess you can.
No matter how bad.
But at one time, you could see Family, King Crimson, and Pink Floyd for $1. In London, it's literally
$1,
like
and they gave you a tab of acid when you walked in the door too.
Where have those times gone? Is what I want to.
But there was a great feeling around about that time that something was happening, mm-hmm. and obviously it was happening because mm-hmm. all those bands are now established and major acts.
Do you currently play any other instruments, do you enjoy listening to classical music?
Oh, very much. Yeah, that's mostly what I listen to at home. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That and a bit of R&B. That's a major influences for me are classical music and
rhythm and blues. So those two mixes is the UK style. Why did you do the UK album in Japan? Did you choose that particular?
No, it was chosen for us. The Japanese record company, excuse me. They said that live albums are so popular in Japan now that any act coming in, it's almost sort of compulsory to do a live album in Japan just for release in Japan.
Yes, do get a look at the live album. We have to wrap it up, very unfortunately.
We'd
like to go
more.
On and on and on, talk about the future of rock and the whole thing. We've been speaking to an expert this evening, John Wetton of UK. We thank you for joining us. It's been a pleasure.
You. Yes, thanks very
we
much.
Wish you the best of luck on in LA and the rest of your tour. Have a good time.
Would you sign my album?
Sure. Yeah.
Oh, fantastic.
Boy.
Yes. The world is watching.
The world
we
is
thank
watching.
You for watching the Boffomundo Show, all ears, that is. And we'll be checking you out in a couple of weeks. So we thank you for watching and tune in again.
Bye-bye.
Good night. Well.